tradition, and folks here have fallen in love with the young Texan Jordan Spieth. The defender is one stroke off the pace that he set last year. He's 5 under par, bogey-free through 14 holes, leads by 2 shots over Justin Rose. At 2 under par, Lee Westwood, Paul Casey, Daniel Berger, and Jason Day, who eagled the second hole. Ernie Els opens with a 10 on the first hole. Rory McIlroy is playing that hole right now. Dan Davis at the Masters.
Live TV coverage of the Masters will begin at 3 o'clock Eastern Time this afternoon on ESPN. They could very well meet the NBA Western Finals next month. Golden State will host San Antonio tonight, 9:30 Eastern on ESPN Radio. The Warriors need to go 4-0 to break the league record for most wins in a season. Afternoon baseball, the Reds have taken a 4-2 lead over the Phillies in the bottom of the fourth on a 3-run fourth inning homer by Jay Bruce.
Custom Ink is the fun, easy way to design custom t-shirts for any occasion. Get started in the online design lab with hundreds of fonts and amazing artwork. You'll even get free shipping. Visit CustomInk.com to order your custom t-shirts today.
This is the Sports Hub on ESPN Radio 1420, 107.1, Northeast South Dakota's sports talk show. On the air on 1420 AM, 107.1 FM, and streaming on ESPNAberdeen.com. Now, let's head to the studios with Ben Root and David Tewksbury.
And welcome on into the Sports Hub, ESPN 1420, 107.1, ESPNAberdeen.com. Ben and Dave here with you on this edition of the program, and a pretty filled edition it is. We've got a couple of coaches joining us here live today via the phone. So thanks to Thomas Edison for that. We've got Kim Zimmerman, head coach of the girls golf team there at Aberdeen Central. He'll be joining us to start things off here in just a few. And we'll chat with the head coach of the Aberdeen Central boys track and field team, getting prepped for more activity this weekend. Finally, not a trip to Brookings. We'll chat with Coach Greg Murley as well on the back half of the program, and sandwiched in between from Track of the Wolves this week, Josie Ostermann, who is in the Northern Track and Field squad. She's dabbled in this and that when it comes to track and field. And this weekend, for the first time, it sounds like she'll be doing a little competing in multiple events, i.e. the Maltese, the Maltese, however you want to pronounce it there. I've heard it both ways. And she'll be doing that, and find out a little bit more about Ms. Ostermann, who's from just south of Minneapolis, just south of Bemidji, more accurately. Or Mankato, is it? No, it's south of Mankato, I think. Now, or is it Bemidji? Anyway, it's south of the Twin Cities by a bit. And we'll have her on the program with a conversation I had with her at Track of the Wolves this week as well. So that's all coming up. We've got your AA All-State Boys Basketball team. Final one of those All-State teams coming out. So we're all set as far as those awards go. That's all wrapped up, although they'll play a little hoops this weekend, Sunday down at Sanford Pentagon. We talked about that before, an additional All-Star game there. It's the Sanford one. Of course, there's so many of those, kind of hard to keep track, but they're doing that Sunday down at Sanford Pentagon, which is a nice place to play. Had some baseball yesterday that did not go the way of the local teams for the most part. A 1-3 collective record for Wednesday there on the Diamond. And we've got a little bit of a schedule here today to remind you of, although, man, playing some tennis or doing any sort of running, jumping, and throwing outdoors in these conditions, I'm sure these high school kids are not going to be having a ton of fun outdoors today. It's maybe a touch warmer now. 42, it says here right now. So, yeah, it's not even warmer than yesterday. So it's just not fun.
No. And I'm wondering, have you thawed out yet? I know yesterday you were broadcasting live from Fossum Field. It was pretty cold out there, pretty breezy. It's actually even worse today, if you can imagine that, breeze-wise. My car, the hipster doofus, or if you will, the toaster, was just going all over the road today. I mean, just all over the place with that wind. I thought there was some gusty winds up to about, what would you say, like 40 miles per hour. It's pretty rough out there.
Yeah, look at the update right now. It says, yeah, gusts at 44.
There you go.
And wind at last check was at 29 out of the northwest. Woof.
So basically, if you hit a pop fly, it's going into the seats in the outfield. You got a shot for it.
Woof. Yeah, so it's not fun. We'll keep you up to date on that here. Maybe I'll keep an eye on what's going on there. Like you said, wind advisory is in full effect in the place to be. Anyhow, that's going on until 6 o'clock tonight. Mm-hmm. Widget.
And kind of a cool thing, something that I have never seen, of course. We'll probably get into this maybe just a little bit because it's really just starting to get revved up today. I'm talking about the the Masters, of course, you've got today, tomorrow, Saturday, and Sunday of the Masters. And one thing that, Ben, I have never seen before. Have you seen what Ernie Els did today at the Masters?
I haven't been able to pay much attention to it today.
He was putting for a quintuple bogey.
Whew.
That didn't go. Then he ended up going for the sextuple bogey. Is that pronounced correctly? I feel like
yep.
it. Okay, yeah. So the sextuple bogey. I've never even, number one, never thought I'd say that word ever in the world, let alone on the air, on the radio. It sounds dirty, but it's not. So he ended up knocking that in. Apparently he had seven putts.
Wow.
I don't know where to go with that. That's just crazy. I've never in my life seen a sextuple bogey attempt. So Ernie Els.
Well. You haven't watched too much John Daly golf then, I guess.
No, I'm too busy watching his pants.
He distracts you with the pants, then you have no idea what he writes on the scorecard.
That's true.
That should work, but every once in a while he'll get something like that. He's had one, you know, one hole every once in a while. I remember seeing him, you know, oh, John Daly shot a 12. What? 12?
Yeah, wait, what?
I just put an X when I get to that point. Why didn't he just do that? I guess I guess that doesn't really fly with the rules committee there.
As Will Ferrell would say with his attire, it's the pleats. It's the pleats.
But right now, checking the scoreboard, man, nice job by Jordan Spieth so far. 5-under through 14. And the favorite going into this thing, Jason Day, not too shabby either, but he's very early on. He's through 3, but he's 2-under already. And sandwiched in between there, if you will, through 10, Justin Rose sitting at 3-under as Spieth looks to go back-to-back, trying to be the fourth person to put that green jacket right back on himself. I'm not sure how that works. I don't remember seeing that happen before, but you take one sleeve off and then kind of take the other one off. And I don't know. I'm not sure. That's very difficult.
I'm waiting for the day when Shooter McGavin is out there and just putting for, you know, basically that green jacket. You know, the gold jacket was a thing. And a lot of people thought Shooter was going to choke, and he did, and Happy sunk that putt somehow. I don't know how, but he made it happen. And for
get
me,
in the hole.
Yeah, you stupid ball, get in the hole. I can't say exactly what he said because I'll get fired. But yeah, man, this is a really cool time. You know, Jim Nance was saying, you know, tradition unlike any other. And speaking of Jim Nance, I heard something kind of interesting about that broadcasting booth. I'm sure we might get a chance to talk about that, but why does it get to be nice and sunny and like 70 degrees out there? That's not fair.
Because that's Georgia.
Why Georgia, John Mayer would say. But anyway, I don't know. This is kind of a random side note. I don't know if you heard about this, but Peyton Manning is trying to go into the broadcasting booth, and word is that he's going to nudge Phil Simms out of the booth and join Jim Nance. So it's going to be Jim Nance and Jim Nance and Peyton Manning as the number one booth on CBS. That's the not conspiracy theory. That's like the word right now that's going out over the interwebs.
Hmm. That would be surprising to me to see him jump in and be one of the top team on CBS right away.
Well, you're looking for ratings, are you not? So that's
Ricky.
That's no good. Well, Ricky Fowler.
Yikes.
Jeez.
Ricky
shirt's a little loud.
Ricky is struggling. Well, that's Ricky Fowler. That's a nice shirt, but
I like that.
Man,
shirt.
He's 5-over and he just sent one into the drink.
Mm.
So Fowler already day one, I would say, danger missing the cut. I mean,
struggling.
Holy smokes, yeah, struggling big time. And yeah, one of my faves, but not going well for him on day one there in Augusta.
One thing that's also kind of cool thing about this right now is that we're apparently broadcasting live on Facebook. So that camera's like staring at me. Hey, Brent, how's it going, guy behind the camera? Yeah, it's kind of
nice.
This is kind of interesting. So yeah, we're broadcasting live on Facebook, which is kind of neat. Can I?
Facebook.com/ESPN Aberdeen.
The mic wasn't on. Ben, can you crank up
there? Do you need a mic there? All right,
I missed it personally.
There
so
you go, Brent. Feel free if you want to jump in.
Facebook.com/ESPN Aberdeen.
All right, there you go. Facebook.com/ESPN Aberdeen /Brent Spear.
/ we rule. That's a whole new story.
Yeah. So we've got golf going on the TV here. Well, highlights. They don't have it actually broadcast there till 2 o'clock our time.
Till two.
For the Masters. So we'll keep you up to date on what's going on with that, though. Watch the highlights and what have you here. And we'll talk golf here in mere moments with Aberdeen Central head coach Kim Zimmerman for the girls squad as they get set for their debut actually this weekend. They'll start things up in Mitchell tomorrow. And we'll talk about that here in just a moment. Give Coach Zimmerman a call here on the Sports Hub, ESPN 1420, 1071.
Over 60 years of history has set up the biggest game changer for dirt track racing in the nation.
I'm going past the Badlands. That's where spirits remain.
On Saturday, May 21st, the legendary Huset Speedway will open its gates as the completely revamped and improved Badlands Motor Speedway. Racing will never be the same. And we want you to be there. Over 40 events in 2016. The best drivers in the nation competing weekly for over $50,000 in prize money. Racing every Saturday and Sunday in Brandon, South Dakota. With huge concerts and special events. Season tickets on sale now as low as $10 per race. You won't believe the transformation. Incredible seating, new restroom, lighting, parking, VIP tower, full bar, all kinds of new food options, and two huge 700 square foot video screens. Log on now to BadlandsMotorspeedway.com for all the details. Become a member of our family and rediscover professional dirt track racing at Badlands Motor Speedway. BadlandsMotorspeedway.com.
Remember Taco John's Street Tacos? They're back, and they're still three for only $5. Taco John's Street Tacos are made with shredded beef or grilled chicken and topped with pico de gallo, crazy good garlic, lime sauce, and crumbled Mexican cheese. And for a limited time, they are back. Back in shredded beef, grilled chicken, and for the first time, glorious golden shrimp. Get three Taco John's Street Tacos for just $5 only at Taco John's. Unwrap the original.
Totally Tubular is your stock steel and aluminum headquarters. Totally Tubular offers the largest stock steel and aluminum inventory in the area, along with great prices and quality customer service. Totally Tubular should be the first call you make when your project is in need of steel or aluminum. You can find Totally Tubular at 703 2nd Avenue Northwest behind the Auto Plaza, or call them at 725-3012. Totally Tubular, your stock steel and aluminum headquarters right here in Aberdeen.
Aberdeen Community Theater, get into the act.
Aberdeen Community Theater presents Northern State University Theater's production of Pride and Prejudice this Wednesday through Saturday at 7:30 and Sunday at 2:30 live on stage at the Capitol Theater. Advance tickets on sale at Riddle's Jewelry in the Aberdeen Mall. Any remaining tickets available at the door. Credit card sales 725-2697 or aberdeencommunitytheater.com. Don't miss Pride and Prejudice in this fresh new adaptation of the Jane Austen classic. That's Pride and Prejudice this Wednesday through Sunday only live on stage at the Capitol Theater.
Catch Northern State Athletics with Ben Root all season long on ESPN Radio 1420 107.1.
Welcome back into the Sports Hub, ESPN 1420 107.1 on the web at ESPNAberdeen.com. It's Ben and Dave here with you in this edition of the Hub. We'll talk Aberdeen Central Boys Track and Field later on this hour. With Coach Murley joining us. Josie Ostermann, who is with the track and field squad, and as you will join us as well. Actually, my conversation with her from Track of the Wolves will be in here also coming up in about 15 minutes. But right now, time to talk some golf with this first day of the Masters. Makes sense to do so. And joined by head coach of the girls squad over at Aberdeen Central, Coach Zimmerman. How you doing, Coach?
Very good, thanks.
You were a little distracted by the TV today with all the golf going on this week?
Well, it's tempting, but I haven't got to it yet, so I'll have to just kind of DVR it and save the best for tonight, I guess.
Right, hopefully I didn't spoil anything earlier when I was saying Speed's in the lead there.
Yeah, stay away from social media.
Exactly. Well, last season, a sixth-place finish for your squad. Not too shabby, really a balanced team. Looking at your team this year, I see the roster is up on the website now, so I can look at it a little bit more because I couldn't remember who all were the seniors and everything, but who are some of the ones that you did graduate off that team? Getting ready for this year, which is a very young team now.
Yeah, actually, we have everybody back, Ben, from last year. Okay. We didn't lose anybody in terms of senior class. But so, you know, that's kind of nice in that respect that we don't have to really rebuild and with any kids that we lost. You know, they're young, but I always tell people they're young, but they're kind of veteran, so to speak, in terms of their experience because they've been in the postseason a few years now, even though that they're, you know, freshmen and sophomores for the most part. So they've gained some good experience in the last few years playing in the ESD and the state championships. They're young, but they have some experience.
Yeah, they've been there and they've done that, I guess you could say, getting to sixth place last year. And, yeah, your oldest one is Michaela Sancher there, junior, Wirebaugh is a sophomore, and then the rest filling in the group there. Have you seen some progression in the early, you know, practices here before you get into that first meet from last year's performances?
Oh, I think so. I mean, just for the fact that we've been able to get outside, I think that I can probably count the number of times on one hand that we've been able to get out and stay out. Sometimes we've been able to get out, and then we have to go back indoors for a while. But It's you know, been a little cooler as of late and windy, but we're still able to get outside and get a lot more done in that way, in that respect, than having to be inside. So we've been able to do some things outside, and I've seen where the girls have gotten stronger and, you know, just kind of, you know, filling into their game a little bit more as far as what they can do. And they played a lot of golf last summer, which really helped out a lot. I know they were in a lot of tournaments, and that's what we encourage them to do. So they not only practiced, but they were in competition, which helped. And I think just being in the role that they were in last year at Rapid City in the state tournament and taking sixth place, bringing home some hardware was encouraging for them, and they just wanted to build on that. And I think they're very excited to get the season underway and see where they're at this year in comparison to last year with, you know, their scores and how they match up with some of the other teams, too. So we're excited to get started next week, though.
Yeah, Coach, obviously the girls have a lot of experience with this, but where do you start the season off? Is it with reading greens? Is it with driving? I think more specifically towards reading greens, how do you take steps in kind of teaching the girls that craft?
Well, that's probably one of the biggest challenges early on because, you know, I said this before, unlike, you know, some of the other sports where you're playing in the same court, same conditions, you know, one day, one week, you're playing on this golf course, which the greens haven't been mowed, maybe as short, and then you go down south and they're maybe mowed a little bit shorter. So it takes a lot of adjusting just because you can go out and practice your short game, say, in Aberdeen here, and then you go down to Yankton, it could be totally different. But you do practice the fundamentals. You do practice, you know, reading the breaks and the grain of the green and those types of things, and kind of knowing where you want to position your putts at if you do miss. And, you know, those are all things that you learn with time. And, you know, it just takes some experience. And like I said, the biggest adjustment is just getting used to the speed of the greens this time of the year, because there's a lot of variation from golf course to golf course in terms of where they're at. For the most part, I was very pleased. I think our golf courses here in Aberdeen have come through the winter very well. I mean, I was out at both Moccasin and Lee Park, and they look like they're in tremendous shape in comparison to where they were last year and the year before. So we're encouraged to get a lot done in that respect of being on the greens, and whereas in the years gone by, we haven't been able to do that.
Do the girls have a preference whether or not they're fast or slow?
I think most of them would like them a little bit slower, for the most part, at least to start out the year. But I think that, you know, obviously as time goes on, they're going to speed up, and they just have to make that adjustment. The thing I hear them talk about once in a while is that they're not consistent on the same golf course where one hole was faster than the other. So we can't do anything about that. That's kind of out of our control. They just have to make those adjustments as time goes on. Sometimes the practice green that you practice on isn't as fast or is slower than the ones out in the course. So those are all things we talk about, and they just have to make the adjustments as they go along. That's just the way it is.
Coach Zimmerman here with us for the Golden Eagles girls golf team here on the Sports Hub at ESPN 1420 and 107.1. Some different things that have gone on with the SDHSAA in the offseason here. If I remember right, kind of altered when you're starting and ending the season this year too, right? I think that's helping you out.
Correct. Or? Correct. Yeah. For the most part, there's a few years have gone by now where not all the state tournaments, but a couple of state tournaments have been shortened to one day because of the weather. And I guess some coaches felt that, you know, let's try something to maybe get a little bit better weather out of the season than what we have had. And so they decided to kind of push the season back a couple weeks. And now we're into June. Our state tournament's going to be into June this year. And I don't know, just this year just so happened to be where you could be out. I think the weather we had in March was probably a little bit warmer and nicer than it is right now. But they just wanted to give the girls an opportunity to maybe play on some courses when they're a little bit more greener and mature coming through the winter than what they have been. And just the fact that, you know, you're dealing with better weather, you know, now it's not going to guarantee anything that in June you're going to have some nice days, but the chances are better that, you know, it will be a little bit nicer and warmer, and the golf courses will be more suited towards, you know, the way they should be, I guess, in terms of being mowed and manicured and taken care of. So I know there was some opposition to that, but, you know, we want to do what's best for the athletes. And I think, you know, the Activities Association is going to give this a try for a couple of years. I don't think it's going to go away in 1 year, but they're going to you know, there's pros and cons to everything. Anytime you change something, there's going to be, you know, some good with it and some bad. But we're going to see how it works. And, you know, so far so good. But the telltale sign will be when school's out and they still have to go to practice and we still have meets, that'll be a little bit different this year than what they're accustomed to.
Yeah, and I think they've had that same situation with feel like track and field was near the end too, or maybe the weekend following or something, or maybe it was tennis, but I think it was track. But yeah, it's all kind of close there as far as the other stuff too on the activities association side of things. If I remember right, either it was just a clarification or it was a change. Did they alter the coaching? You know, what you could do as far as coaching again? Because I know, right, you know, before it was you could do nothing, and then it was now it's they're clarifying tee to green situations.
Yeah, as far as coaching, yeah, they proposed and it passed that we can now coach. Well, I shouldn't say that yet. It's got to go through the Activities Association. It went through the Golf Advisory in the 80s, passed it, so now it's got to go through one more hurdle before it's approved. But what has been proposed is that coaches can coach even their athletes up to the green, and then once they tee off, you can coach again. So, yeah, you're correct in saying that. That is, you know, that's something that the coaches felt that, you know, we kind of felt helpless, like we coach them all year throughout the practices and everything, and then the meets got here and we couldn't do that. So, but they want to be able to coach a little bit more at some of these meets than what we've been able to. Right now, you know, we can, you know, definitely encourage them and talk to them a little bit, but that's something that we really want to get past and kind of put forth as far as what we can do out there on the course with them. You know, and a lot of it's more, I think, you know, emotional, mental stuff. You're not going to get into the mechanical, the fundamental stuff with the kids out in the course, but just, you know, they have a bad hole, they have a bad shot or something like that, just to, you know, encourage them, bring their, you know, their attitude and their morals up a little bit as far as, you know, what we need to do and to stay focused and things like that.
Coach, I'm wondering, do you have a specific course around town, either here or somewhere else in the state, that you feel like the girls really excel at, or is it all just kind of you're taking it day by day, you see what it is when you get there? Or do you have a specific one that you think is in great shape, or do you have a preference where you guys play?
No, we generally bounce back and forth between Moccasin and Lee. Occasionally we'll get over to Rolling Hills and play, but you know, I guess the downfall there is they don't have a driving range. But they do have some greens that maybe Lee and Moccasin don't have in terms of the undulation and the break and the size of them a little bit. So I think each of the three courses in Aberdeen is kind of unique in their own way as to the layout of the course, the length of the course, that type of thing. And we like to mix it up. We don't like to get, you know, too set in being in one place, you know, every day. And not only that, we have some other teams in town, too, that practice, and we don't want to overrun the golf courses with, you know, the high school and the college golf teams. So we try to, you know, spread it out a little bit and not, you know, kind of be in one place too often and, you know, kind of spread the wealth a little bit, so to speak.
How often do you get over to practice at Wiley? Is there, you know, good putting practice over there, I guess?
They're probably a little bit speedier there now than they are at the other places, but
of course, not a lot of courses have turf like that, so
right,
you don't
right.
see that too often. You get ready for your season opener, are you having the trip to Mitchell tomorrow? I heard you say next week earlier as far as
right.
your opener.
Right, that one got moved back a couple weeks for whatever reason. I'm not sure. I just was told that it's now April 22nd, which is on a Friday. So that got moved. Our opening meet is Thursday, April 14th at Harrisburg, which is kind of unique because we've never played Harrisburg. I've never been to the course. I don't know anything about it really, other than what the boys' coach have told me. He's been down there a couple times. But so it'll be a new experience for us going to Harrisburg and playing that course. And I heard it's pretty, you know, hilly down there, which we're not accustomed to in this part of the country. So It'll present a little bit of a challenge in that respect. But so we have another week of practice to kind of get ready and prepare a little bit for that meet. And then, you know, after next week, we kind of get into about two or three meets a week. Usually two meets a week after next week, we'll kind of get into more of our full schedule, I guess you could say. But, I'm basically practicing with six girls right now, which consist of the varsity. I'll just very briefly go through those. I haven't had a chance to. Sydney Wirebaugh is a sophomore. Michaela Sancher, a junior. So those two have kind of been around with me for the most part. And then we go to four freshmen, Jada Sanderson, Cassidy Goff, Brooklyn Hofer, and Cameron Whiff. So four freshmen, junior, and a sophomore is basically what our team consists of right now. So they're excited. They're working hard. They're playing in the weekends. They're doing everything that I can ask of them to kind of prepare for the season so far.
I'm curious as to how you deal with being at the mercy of the weather, because, you know, a lot of times, like you said, you're pushing things back because of whether it being too cold or too windy or it's rainy outside. Is that a conscious effort on your part to talk to the girls and sit down with them and say, hey, you know, a lot of times, you know, they're getting all revved up for a big meet or what have you, then all of a sudden you can't do it because of the rain or wind or cold. Is that something that you consciously talk about with the girls, being at the mercy of the weather at times?
Well, I think we do, and we always talk about kind of the mental approach of it more so than anything. That, you know, I think the strongest will, the toughest mentally prepared golfer is going to do well out there. And, you know, to talk about it and to actually try to play a few holes in those type of conditions once in a while is probably beneficial. You know, there's not a lot of people that go out and play golf when it's a little, you know, wet or raining outside or cold outside. They generally go out on the nicest day they can find. Otherwise, they don't go out. Where, you know, during our season, we have to kind of play in some conditions that are less than ideal, for that reason, that, you know, here's how you have to dress. Here's how you have to keep your clubs dry. You know, those types of things are all very important, because if you go into a meet not really knowing how or what to do, I mean, it's going to be, you're going to be fighting the elements more than you will your golf game. And golf's tough enough on nice days to try to go out and play well, let alone to have the wind blowing or it raining, things like that. So we do talk about the mental approach, you know, in terms of the weather more so than anything, and then just trying to go out and play under the conditions once in a while when we can. Not to beat them up out there, but just to go out and play a few holes and say, hey, this is what it's going to be like, so prepare for it. And believe it or not, the girls really do a phenomenal job. I know there's a lot of us coaches that say, you know, the scores they shoot are kind of like, we're not sure where they're coming from, because the average person wouldn't be able to go out and do that. But somehow they grind it out, and, you know, they do the best they can, and they do a great job at it.
As we wrap things up here with Coach Zimmerman, the Central Girls Golf Head Coach on the Sports Hub, that trip to Mitchell, you mentioned that's been moved to the 22nd there. I know you've got another trip to Mitchell down the road, plus state tournament is there at the Lakeview course. Are these other ones, either one of them, that same course?
Correct. They're both there.
Okay. So you get to check it out a few times.
Yeah, it's definitely going to give us an opportunity to play the course. These girls have played it already a few years now, so it's not something new to them. But they kind of know there's a couple holes in that course that can kind of jump up and bite you if you don't take care of your game a little bit there. So. But, you know, it's a nice golf course. It's pretty lengthy. They have some lengthy holes, but fair. And, you know, it's just a nice place to have a golf tournament there. So it's nice to be able to go down there. I know the golf course will change, but it's nice to go down there and play it a couple times prior to the state tournament. So that's what those two meets will afford us to do, I guess.
Well, sounds good. Enjoy the start of your season coming up here next week. And wrapping things up, do you have a pick for the Masters this week, a favorite of yours?
You know, to be honest with you, I don't. I'm a Tiger Woods fan, and I probably will be, but so it's kind of taken that part of that element out of the golf tournament for me. But there's a lot of other, you know, good young players and stuff that are, and so I really don't have a favorite, I guess, or really know who's gonna do well. It comes down to the last day and the last back nine. That's always interesting, regardless who's in contention. It's always a lot of things, drama, and things that can happen. So I'll be tuned in come Sunday.
All right. Sounds good. Thanks, Coach. Appreciate it.
All right. Thank you.
Thanks, Coach Zimmerman there, talking some girls' golf over at Aberdeen Central. This on Sports Hub at ESPN 1420 and 107.1.
Yeah, it's kind of like Roncalli last year. Remember when they had the region tournament that was at the exact same golf course there in Milbank? Kind of cheating. Not cheating, but for lack of a better word, you know, they're, you know, kind of cheating the system there a little bit. They played their last game, or was it the region there?
Yep, regions were there.
And then the state was there as well, right?
Coach is, you know, prior Bulldog, first-year head coach, yep. Ryan Patino, who's still over at NSU. And, yeah, leads the team to the state title over there. He didn't jump on the course and play or anything.
Right.
But that would have been really fishy.
Yeah, the word cheat is not the right word, but that's the only thing I can think of at this point in time. Maybe a leg up on the program.
Use your positioning in the state to your advantage. Everything you can
do. That's right.
You know? There are no five-fingered wedges or anything out there.
That's true.
Nobody grabbing the ball, at least that I heard of. I think we would have heard about that.
Yet.
No foot wedge. Coming up, we've got Aberdeen Central Boys Track and Field Head Coach Greg Murley joining us on the back nine, if you will. Hey-o.
Oh.
But before that, I chatted with Josie Ostermann with the Northern Track and Field team on Track of the Wolves yesterday. That conversation is coming up next as we keep it going here on the Wolves the Sports Hub. That's what it is at ESPN 1420-1071.
At Groton Ford, we believe in relationships. That's why we work so hard to establish new ones every day. Regardless of who you are or what you do, most people do business with people they like and trust. If you haven't been to Groton Ford yet, I invite you to stop by, visit grotonford.com, or follow us on Facebook. We're a pretty good bunch. From all of us at Groton Ford, thank you.
Your friend in the car business, I'm going to Groton Ford.
This is Vivi of the Thomas Ranch reminding you of our upcoming bull sale, Tuesday, April 12th, 1 p.m. at the Thomas Ranch Sales Facility, east of Oneida. We're offering 300 head of performance and fertility-tested Charlet, Angus, Sim Angus, and Red Angus bulls that all sell with the Thomas Ranch Guarantee. We will also be selling 100 replacement heifers. Visit thomasranchcattle.com or call to request a catalog, 973-2448. The sale broadcasts on Superior Livestock, Tuesday, April 12th at 1 p.m.
With your locally owned Aberdeen Pharmacy's Med Synchronization Service, we'll help you save time and money by coordinating all your prescriptions into one monthly pickup.
Managing all my medications didn't fit into my busy schedule, so my Health Mart pharmacist coordinated everything. They even remind me when they're ready, so now I can pick them up when it works for me.
Visit Plaza Pharmacy, State Street Pharmacy, or United Clinic Pharmacy today to simplify your refills and your life. Health Mart, caring for you and...
Dakota Ink and Toner is your source for printers and cartridges, whether you have one printer at home or multiple printers pumping out thousands of sheets per day. Call Dakota Ink and Toner at 226-5900 to see how you can save on your printing and copying needs, or stop in and see us at 205 South Main Street.
A wind advisory remains in effect for our area this afternoon as we'll stay with a mix of clouds and sunshine at a high of around 50. Northwest winds will gust around 20 to 35. For tonight, with partly cloudy skies, we'll head down to 26 with northwest winds diminishing to 10 to 20.
Welcome back to this edition of Track of the Wolves with yours truly, Ben Root, as we talk a little track and field on this edition. And joining me, we've got a sophomore off the track and field squad on the women's side, Josie Ostermann, who runs in the hurdles and does some sprinting as well. And she joins us on this week's show. Thanks for coming on the show, Josie.
No problem.
Always like to find out a little bit about student-athletes' hometowns. You're from Amboy, Minnesota, which was a new one for me to have to look up and figure out where that is. Can you tell us a little bit about where it is in Minnesota, and you know, what's the main thing we should know about your hometown?
Well, it's about 30 miles south of Mankato, and I guess there's not really that much to it, but I live more like in the country. That's really close to Amboy, but it's a pretty small town, and basically, you know, everybody, like your neighbors and stuff, and there's a bar there that everybody goes to and eats at.
So that's about it. Not you said just a couple hundred people, I think, earlier, right? So your family kind of live on a farm then, or
no, just in the country.
Okay, so a big family, or
I have two other brothers, so I guess it's still pretty small.
Older brothers, or
I have an older brother and then a younger brother.
Okay,
so I'm the middle child.
Does that work out all right for you?
It does, actually.
One to protect you, and then one to hassle.
Exactly.
What would you say your city is best known for? Is there anything particular about Amboy that people are like, oh, that's such and such is there?
I guess not really. There used to be a really cool like middle school there that like if you went to that middle school that like you're like in love with it, that like everybody liked it going there.
That sounds cool. So I'm guessing the main place you'd go to would be there like Mankato or maybe the Twin Cities as far as going to for a big trip somewhere.
Yeah, Mankato usually.
What would be the main like food place you would go hang out at or go have dinner at or something?
Well, I guess like the mall, there's a lot of food choices in the mall. Like growing up, like me and my friends would always want to go there and like eat and of course shop. Otherwise there's like my family and I always like to go to like Buffalo Wild Wings.
Okay. And coming from Minnesota and kind of small town there, a lot of, seems like small town kind of on the men's and women's side, student athletes on track and field team. What brought you all the way to NSU from out there?
Just being recruited for track.
They get approached by Coach Bierke. Mm-hmm.
And they have a good education program since I major in education. Okay. That was also a good benefit.
Where else were you getting recruited?
At River Falls in Wisconsin, and then Gustavus, that's in also St. Peter, Minnesota,
okay.
Near Mankato.
They're
Division III.
D3, okay. I was going to say, names are familiar, but I don't see them a lot against NSU or anything. So what kind of put Northern over the top to come to Aberdeen?
I guess I just wanted to, like, get further away, cause since River Falls is kind of close, like a couple hours too, and then St. Peter, that's like an hour, so I just wanted to get a little further away.
Still close enough to take trips home and everything, right?
Sometimes, like during holidays. Otherwise, it's too far to drive on like weekends, but
especially
holidays for sure.
In the winter, that's for sure.
Yeah, exactly.
What's been the biggest adjustment to living in Aberdeen?
Being away from my family. It was a lot harder than I thought it'd be since I'm so close to them. It's been a struggle. My freshman year, I got homesick a lot, but it's gotten a lot better, so that's the biggest thing.
Roommate or that's on the team or anything? Or?
I did have a roommate my freshman year on the team, and we got pretty close.
Okay. As far as the adjustment, a lot of times people are talking about moving in Aberdeen, and it's from a bigger city and trying to adjust to the small town. Has it been kind of weird being the other way around? I mean, this is bigger than 200, obviously.
Yeah, I guess it was kind of weird, but since, like, I went to Mankato a lot, that it's more adjusting from Mankato to Aberdeen, so that was kind of hard, too.
So you kind of used to being, since it's only a half hour away, the Mankato.
Exactly.
So. Looking at the activity in track and field, sprinter and hurdler, how did you kind of start your track and field competition, and were you starting in these events when you started up, whatever age that was?
Yeah, I started track my junior year of high school, and I started sprinting and hurdling right away.
Okay. What kind of brought you into track and field? Just did a coach, because I know I saw you played basketball and volleyball as well.
Mm-hmm.
Coach kind of say, hey, we need to get her running and jumping, what have you?
I did softball until like my sophomore year, and then I was just kind of like, wasn't like my thing anymore, so then I was either debating on golf or track, and then went with track, and that's how it all started.
Okay. Well, it's cheaper than golf, so
yeah.
That's good. What was your first thought when you tried to learn the hurdles?
I don't know. I just, like, really wanted to do it, like, right away. It didn't really seem, like, that hard, I guess, but I was, like, determined to do it.
Okay. See, I don't know, tall, 6 foot's not really that tall to me because I hang around, you know, the basketball team or whatever. But I always thought hurdles were too high. You never thought they were too difficult to jump over? It was no problem for you?
No. Okay. But because, like, men's hurdles, like, they're so much higher than the women's. And
oh, okay.
So I guess it's easier for the woman to
Maybe I can handle that. Maybe I need to run on women's hurdles. That'll be easier. Have you ever had any bad spills off of those things?
Yeah.
Just get kind of used to it, or how do you?
Yeah, it's only happened to me like twice, maybe, and like the times that I have fallen, I just like get back up and finish because I haven't been like hurt, I guess, when I fall, so I just get back and finish the race.
So no injuries, mainly just scrapes.
Yeah, just scrapes. A little embarrassment from falling.
About it. What would you say is the toughest event if you were to try and do something else in track and field?
I would say the 800 or 400, which I ran both of those, and they're both really hard to me. So I don't like to run them a lot, but when I do, it's challenging.
Just a little too far?
Yeah, definitely too far.
What's the difference as far as the indoor and outdoor season? Because you've got, we're just kind of switching to outdoor now. Are they different distances or?
Yeah, I guess it's better for to run outdoor for long distance because, like, indoor you have to run so many laps, and then outdoor it's less. And then sprint-wise, like, instead of 60-meter hurdles, I have to do the 100-meter hurdles. And then you get, like, javelin thrown in there when you go outdoor.
Okay. Do you find it better, do you prefer the indoor or the outdoor for your events?
I like both, I guess. It doesn't really matter to me. I like the 60-meter hurdles because there's only like six hurdles compared to 10.
See, it seems a lot shorter. I remember seeing that down in Kansas when we went down there and saw some of that stuff. I mean, they're practicing on three, and that's, you know, half of the half of the event. Now, if you were to play another sport like volleyball or basketball, which you played there at Maple River, which would you play, or would you play pick something else to compete in college?
I'd probably pick basketball. I also want to do that in college because I've really been passionate about that, and volleyball as well. But basketball is actually like one of my favorite sports to play.
Yeah, what position were you?
I'm a shooting guard.
Shooting guard. Okay. Mm-hmm. Have you ever gotten out there on the volleyball team that plays in the city league? Because I know track and field team has a team. We swept them this week, by the way. So have you ever gotten on that team or anything for a co-ed?
I have. Like, I've gotten like picked up like once to play. I don't know if it's like what you're talking about, but
they play on Sundays or.
Oh yeah,
the arena and everything.
I've played once.
I know. Every time I see the team, it seems like just different players. So
yeah.
A lot of athletes on the team that seem like they're good players in that. So. Do you have a favorite facility as far as when you guys go on the road? It seems like you go a lot of different places. I know, you know, Kansas this past weekend and a lot of indoor different things. Is there a certain place that kind of sticks out to you?
I like the indoor at Mankato, MSU's. It's a pretty good facility in there.
Okay. Is good it track. On the newer side or?
I don't know. I think it's recently like redone.
Okay. Like built. Is it just what's. What do you like about it? Is it kind of just spongy or?
Kind of, I don't know, just like running, like being like a track athlete. Like there's like tracks like you like to run on that you don't like to run on, and a lot of people seem to like running on that one.
And it's different one, like I didn't realize there were different sizes of tracks indoors too. Like some do smaller, some do bigger.
Like that's a 200 meter track, and ours at Northern is 160 meters.
Okay.
So it's nicer to run, like if you're running a 400, it's better to run at like Mankato compared to here. Because you have to run like 2.5-3 laps almost.
The fewer turns, the better.
Yeah.
Definitely. You have a favorite meet that you've been a part of? Because I know some of your meets are, you know, you have D1 teams there and everything.
Yeah.
They're pretty huge. What's been the most fun so far?
I guess conference meets are pretty fun because then you have like your like good level of competition, I guess. But then when you get like the D1 like athletes thrown in there, kind of like. Psychs me out, I guess, but then, like, I don't know, if, like, you beat them in a certain event, like, you feel, like, really proud of yourself, I guess.
Yeah, I would think that'd be fun. I mean, a lot of buzz, a lot of people around, as long as it's not too crowded, I guess, right? I mean, you're not running in, like, a cross country. That's what kind of makes me, like, when I see that type of thing, or, you know, you have all these people all bunched up, a lot more.
So many people.
At least you have lanes. Hopefully people stay in the lanes.
Yeah, exactly.
As you get ready to hit the road this weekend going down to Missouri, where do you think you need to improve the most here in the when you go to the outdoor season now?
Probably on my throwing, since I'm going to be throwing jab and shot put this weekend. That just need to be improving on that.
Is coach trying to get you into the, you know, the what is it?
Not
multi? The pentathlon, but yeah. The multi stuff?
Okay. Yeah, so I'm actually competing in the multi this weekend.
Oh,
right. So, also in the 800, I have to work on that since I'll be doing that this weekend.
So a lot of stamina stuff, I guess, there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know how you pull off the multi stuff. The high jump to me is still the toughest, though.
It's challenging, definitely.
I don't know how you do that. well, on the class side of things, talking here with Josie Ostermann for the track and field team, you mentioned education major is what you're working on?
Yep.
Everything going all right with that? You still taking GA classes, I guess, or...?
I'm like getting into my block schedule.
Oh, okay. What's your favorite class you're taking right now?
Probably my Spanish class since it's Spanish education I'm majoring in. So my Spanish classes are really fun to me.
Is that the first year of that then or second year of Spanish or?
Second year.
Took some in high school probably?
Yeah, I did. Okay. 2 years in high school.
So it's muy fácil then for you. And last but not least, if you could add a business here on campus, any sort of business, you know, doesn't have to be a restaurant, but some people choose that. What would you add on campus to just make life easier?
Oh, I guess if we're a restaurant, like if it was on campus, like a Chipotle or something.
Okay.
It'd be really good.
Sticking with the Mexican food there.
So yeah.
All right, well, thanks for joining us on the show, and good luck this weekend.
Yeah, thank you.
When driving, buckle up, adjust your mirrors, and check your blind spot before you push on the...
Hey, how's it going?
Accelerator. It's important to keep your hands at 9 and...
When did you guys leave Jason's? I wanted to stay, but I was so tired.
At 9 and 3. Remember to use your blinker at least one...
Ugh, the struggle is real.
100 feet before a turn. And always drive at or under the speed
here?
Limit.
Movie
Make sure you leave
five.
Plenty of following
Popcorn
distance,
emoji.
Allowing more
Smiley
space.
Face emoji.
Oh, come on! It's hard listening to two things at once. Doing two things at once isn't any easier. Visit lessonlearnedsd.com and watch 3 short videos on distracted driving and more for your chance to win $10,000. That's right, one South Dakota teen will win 10 G's. Enter today at lessonlearnedsd.com.
Just don't do it while you're driving.
No purchase necessary. Open to South Dakota teens age 14 to 19. Visit lessonlearnedsd.com for official contest rules. Brought to you by the South Dakota Office of Highway Safety, South Dakota Broadcasters Association, and this station.
Ace is the place with the helpful hardware, folks.
I think my garden is cursed.
I told Dominic Miracle-Gro garden soil with moisture control helps gardens flourish and protects against over and under watering.
Ace is the place where a miracle cancels out a curse.
Now through Monday, don't miss over $250 in instant savings on select products throughout the store, including our best brands like Miracle-Gro. Ace Rewards members save instantly in-store through April 11th. Store stock only. See participating stores for details.
Attention, this is a tax service announcement from Jackson Hewitt. One mistake on your taxes can cost you boatloads of money. Stop by Jackson Hewitt and a trained tax pro will dig deeper to get you 100% accuracy, maximum refund guaranteed. Plus, you may qualify to get $50 on an American Express serve card after you file with us. Hurry to any of our 6,300 locations. Jackson Hewitt, where taxes are less taxing. Minimum tax prep fee required for $50 gift. Valid at participating locations. Terms and conditions apply for all offers. See JacksonHewitt.com for details.
Your home for the Minnesota Twins. ESPN Radio 1420 107.1.
Sports Hub at ESPN 1420, 107.1 on the web, too, at ESPNAberdeen.com. Ben or Dave here with you this edition of the Hub. And we've got one more guest joining us here on the show to wrap up this edition of the Sports Hub. If we have time, we'll get to some of the other notes from yesterday. If you want to find out all the sports info from yesterday, though, just check out our website, ESPNAberdeen.com. It's all right there, driven by LustAuto.com.
And don't forget, powered by NVC.
There you go, too. I'm not making a power-up noise, though. Sorry.
Fine.
It's time now to talk some boys track and fields as we're joined by the head coach of the Golden Eagles squad over at Aberdeen Central, Coach Greg Murley with us. How you doing, Coach?
Pretty good.
Well, a couple of events in the books, two trips to Brookings. So you got that route all down, I guess. But a couple of events in. How do you like how your guys are performing early in the season?
You know, I'm pretty excited about the team. Boy, the Brookings facility, what great facility to go down and be able to run a 300-meter track. Pretty lucky to be able to do that. But, you know, we're progressing. We've had two meets in, but a lot of our guys that were scorers last year for us really only have one meet in. They took a week off between basketball and track, and we're kind of progressing. The weather's been really great this year to get us going, and the workouts have been really good.
Well, it sounds good. And those Brookings, both of them were indoors, so you have to start braving the elements soon pretty much, though, huh?
Yeah, it sounds like we're going to be a little bit cold tomorrow night in Huron, but that's okay. We know how to bundle up in South Dakota, and we have a pretty good regimen of equipment that we take with us to stay warm. So it'll be a good test for us tomorrow night to see how we can do in the outdoors.
Well, as you mentioned there, some of the guys, as far as, you know, the ones that scored points for you at last year's state meet, one of them I know that's gone graduating was Sam Shoneman, but do you lose many seniors off of this squad?
Next year or this year?
From last year. I know Sam graduated, but you bring most of your guys back from last season, don't you?
Yeah, we do. You know, Sam and Lincoln, We're over there in the throws, and Mark Seitz was a relay and a full vulture for us. We lost. But, yeah, we returned a pretty good nucleus. You know, Anthony Bachmeyer is a state placer. Lane Keeson is recovering from a knee operation, but we think he'll be – he's actually going to go on Friday night for the first time. Anthony Heinert – or the Heinert is – Jake Heinert's coming back from last year's team, was on a couple relays. Chan Hagen was a conference champion for us last year in the triple jump. So, yeah, we have a nice little nucleus coming back, and we have some guys that are kind of up-and-comer, like Preston Barr is going to be starting off a couple of our sprint relays this year, who's a sophomore, and Tristan Brown, who's a sophomore, who's been vaulting pretty well for us. We're hoping he can get something done. Cole Martins wasn't able to finish the season last year because of a calf injury, and he's looking pretty good at this point. So we're pretty excited about some of the things, along with Dylan Vincent in the hurdles and high jump.
Yeah, Coach, I noticed that there's a lot of friendly faces from the basketball program that's on the track and field team as well. Any nagging injuries with some of the guys? Obviously, a really quick turnaround from basketball season. Obviously, the program also went to state there. So any nagging injuries? It's a really quick turnaround for you guys.
Well, it is. I mean, we seem pretty healthy in that. You know, Lane had a football injury that he had to have scoped, and that's kind of about it. You know, the boys have it kind of tough coming from the basketball to track, but, you know, some of our girls teams, if you think about what our girls have done, they went from playing a state championship game on Saturday night in volleyball to Monday morning starting basketball track. So, you know, our kids that are multi-sport athletes are pretty committed kids, and they work out all summer, and so they just really want to do it, and they're competitive. So on the boys' side, too, you know, we have six or eight boys that play that do basketball, track, and football, or basketball, track, and soccer. And you know, so they want to compete. That's their mentality.
Talking to Coach Murley here, Aberdeen Central Boys Track and Field on the Sports Zone. I guess it's probably better that you transition, too, from what we call sometimes a track meet in some basketball games than to transition from football, because some of those guys can really get beat up from that sport, I suppose.
Yeah. So, I mean, we've been pretty lucky at this point. We're healthy at this point, so.
What would you say are some of the strongest spots on your squad right now? I know Cannon got a first-place finish in the old triple jump last week. That probably one of your top spots right now?
I think our relays are going to be pretty competitive. Jake Heinert's going to I think you're going to see Jake Heinert really come out in the 400. He's always been kind of a football guy and lifted all winter to stay in shape for football. And he's a little, 10, 15 pounds smaller this year. He's already around 53 second quarter. Anthony Bachmeyer, is our school record holder. He's run a 48 second quarter this year. He'll be really good. Cannon, obviously, we hope. Our high jumpers, Colin Stabner and Dylan Vincent, have been jumping pretty well, too. They're both up around 6 feet. So we're pretty excited about that.
You know, some of these guys, we talk about them, like you said, multi-sport athletes. You see them do all different events. And, we see some of the schools, over at Evans Central, you got Dylan Northrup winning a bunch of events, and some of these guys, compete in multi-events as well. And you think at any point we end up with actual multis being added at the high school level, like we see at, Northern or what have you, where guys are in a pentathlon or what have you?
Well, those are run over a two-day period, and we don't have two-day meets. So to run a decathlon in one day, I think it would be pretty risky to a kid's health. So, no, I don't, I don't see that one. It wouldn't shock me if at some point we had, like, a javelin throw, but South Dakota track, it's going to change pretty slowly. It's got 100 years of history, so things don't change very quickly in sports that have been around that long.
Okay, yeah, I wasn't even thinking of javelin. I guess if they're going to make a move, that would probably be the first thing to do, right?
Probably, yeah.
Right, something like that. Looking at the state event last year, it was Roosevelt, and then Lincoln and Stevens, the top three teams. Who do you think are some of the favorites this year?
Well, you know, Roosevelt certainly ran some really nice times the other day in Harrisburg. So, you know, those Sioux Falls schools are pretty good. You might see kind of a similar thing. I could see Watertown maybe sneaking in there, and they've got a couple sprinters that were kind of beat up at the end of last year. If they can stay healthy, they might be kind of in that top four contender spot.
All right, so Watertown looking pretty good as far as the ESD teams go there, and we'll keep an eye on them. As far as your squad, it's, like I said, trip to Huron coming up this weekend. How big is that event coming up there?
Well, it's not a huge... We don't go hard at it as far as entries go. We're trying to get kids some experience. We have some young kids. For example, Jonah Dors didn't come out as a freshman, but he came out as a sophomore, and we're trying to figure out where to place some of those kids and where they can help the team most. So we're real early in the season, and just making sure we stay healthy. You can't be competitive unless you have a full squad at the end of the year. So that's kind of our number one. And number two is just finding kids experiences to compete.
Coach, what's the standard practice look like for you guys? You know, there's you know, the big three sports, you know, football, basketball, baseball. Then you got the other kind of sports that a lot of people might not know about, you know, more specifically track and field and whatnot. What's a standard practice look like for you guys?
Well, I'm not sure what you're talking about, the big three. I think we're a pretty big sport. We have 120 kids out for track, so I would say we're one of the big sports around. But, you know, it breaks down. We have a great coaching staff, and you know, what you'd see is our kids come in warming up together as a team, and then we break off into, if you're a sprinter, you go with the sprinters. If you're a distance runner, you come with distance. Throwers go with throwers. And a lot of kids have to go from coach to coach, you know. A kid like Dylan Vincent might go from herbal workout with Coach Apple to high jump with Coach Northrup. A kid like Ken Hagen might have to do baton handoff and a sprint workout and then go over and work with Coach Norberg on the long and triple jump. So, it's pretty individualized, and we have to kind of keep kids organized and let them know where they're supposed to be.
So kind of all over the place there, and see how it goes in competition tomorrow, and work our way towards the big event in late May. You got another question there, Dave?
Yeah, just one real quick question here before we get going, Coach. Like you said, you're kind of a really individualized sport. So with that being said, how do you keep the guys, you know, a really tight-knit group?
Well, it is individualized, but, you know, we're there to support each other. And I think every team is unique. This team doesn't need a bunch of direction to go over and tell a kid like Anthony Bachmeyer to go over and watch the throws and support the jumps or whatever. Those guys want to do that. They want to be good teammates. They want to be good citizens. And I think a lot of it is just explain to the kids that, you know, we are a team and we want to go and support each other. And you know, we talk every night in practice about with the distance runners and sprinters, you're here to make each other better. You're here to push each other. You're here to encourage each other. During the course of a practice, you'll see a lot of high fives that, you know, just got three more to go, guys. Let's go. And you really hear a lot of encouragement. So cross-country and distance running, we talk a lot about shared suffering. And the concept is basically we're in this together, and it's going to be a little painful sometimes, but we're in it together, and we're going to go through it together. So I think those kind of things in the distance run area bring some closer together. I think maybe our throwers use buffets and stuff to come closer as a team. I don't know. So.
Well, it's I think that's a good way to bond through, you know, understanding what everybody's going through kind of out there and you know, cheering on their teammates for a good team score, really.
You know, we were talking about past seniors. Sam Schaumann was a discus and throw shot putter, which a lot of times are in areas far away from the track. And I would argue that he's one of the best teammates I've ever seen. So, I mean, it's an individual choice if you want to be a good team and a good, you know. So, and we make sure they know there's opportunities to do that. And most kids want to do that. want to be a part of something bigger than themselves.
Yeah, and they schedule it well enough that you're not competing to split everybody up out there, too. It's, you know, events aren't all run at the same time and stuff, so that helps out.
Yes.
So, well, good luck on the trip to Huron tomorrow, and we'll chat with you again down the road, Coach.
All right, thank you.
All right, thanks, Coach Greg Murley there with the Aberdeen Central Boys Track and Field team here on the Sports Hub at ESPN 1420 and 107.1.
Yeah, I guess when I mean the big three sports, I guess I mean more nationally. Certain here are a little more localized. Like he said, what did he say, 140 people out for track and field? So certainly I would say there's no question that it's a big sport here, but I guess more nationally level. I think the number, the three sports most people look at would say basketball, football, baseball.
Yeah, usually big four, but... Hockey's gone by the wayside for some people. But
where's the ring in Big Four though, Ben?
I still put it big. It's always been Big Four. I have always said it, and usually how I hear.
Yeah, well, you're from California.
Yeah, where hockey is big, believe it or not.
Hey, it's massive.
It is. I've got friends that play in hockey leagues down in there, and
yeah, no, I'm not being sarcastic.
What have you? So people scratch your head when you tell them that type of stuff. Why do they even have a team? What, two teams? Yes, two teams. So there's a lot of people in Southern California, in case you never heard of that. Anyhow, got to do something. There's
because that beach thing is just
hey, so you got to cool off sometimes, man. You just go in there and watch a game. Mm-hmm. Don't have to bring a jacket or anything. It's fine. It feels good. So that's going to do it for us today. We got Mike and Mark coming up here in just a moment with Calling All Sports tomorrow. I have rescheduled that chat with ex-North Star and ex-Blackhawk, Tom Reed, who is your color guy with the radio broadcast for the Minnesota Wild. Solo, because Dave will be flying out with Brent, flying via vehicle, but I've seen how they drive. They'll be headed out to the Twin Cities. So I will be chatting with Tom Reed tomorrow about the Minnesota Wild, who, now have punched that ticket to the playoffs. So
that's right.
Scratch half the questions I had to ask him about, to alter those, I guess. But they will be the eighth seed. One more game this season Saturday. For the regular season, they will host Calgary. And this weekend, your Minnesota or your Aberdeen Wings will see if they can follow suit and get into the postseason as well. Although they won't really be able to back in like the Wild did this week after losing yet again. And still getting in because of Colorado's loss. So we'll talk to Reed tomorrow and get you ready for a busy sports weekend here in Northeast South Dakota. That's going to do it for us. Back at it tomorrow right here at ESPN 1420. 107.1.